Counter-Strike 2 was released as an ambitious upgrade for the well-known game series. Based on the second iteration of Source Engine, CS2 provides a lot of graphical improvements and makes the well-known maps look better than ever. Aside from visual aspects, there are many other technical improvements that were announced regarding adjusting and polishing the game's competitive mechanics. Has Valve managed to achieve that? What it turned out to be in the end? This is what we are to talk about in this episode. Hello, and welcome back to Hardware Lab. This video is divided in two major parts, visual and gameplay mechanical aspects of CS2, but obviously they have some common ground. It is also worth mentioning that any technical improvements in the Counter-Strike series are always limited by performance. Implementing any feature requires a lot of optimization and cutbacks to be done, because CS is a strongly competitive game where 3-digit FPS higher than a monitor refresh rate is mandatory for a confident player. Taking that in mind, any noticeable visual improvement should be appreciated, and we will test the game performance later in the video. But now, let's dive into the new Counter-Strike rendering system. One of the most noticeable advantages of CS2 visuals in comparison to a previous game is a new global illumination system. Unfortunately, the particular method of GI rendering isn't mentioned in any official materials, but some statements can be done without them. First, it's a static system. Despite the variety of real-time GI techniques available today, they are still pretty demanding, so even some modern games like Starfield tend to rely on legacy GI systems. There is nothing wrong with it, it depends on the game preferences. In Starfield, the save resources allowed to achieve the better overall detailization with incredible LODs, PBR, etc. In CS2, the resources are saved to achieve a competitive performance on a variety of mid-range and low-end machines. Taking in mind CS gameplay and the fact that there is not much light interactions available for players, not even mentioning static time of day, it seems that static GI system is the best choice. Second, the system is pretty accurate and detailed. There are some shots where light bounces feel a bit incorrect and manually placed by an artist for additional effect, which looks mediocre at best in our opinion. Though in most of the scenes the light bounces exactly as it should be in real life, accurately blending the light source color with the colors of bouncing objects. And to be fair, it looks incredibly good. Would you even believe these shots showing high quality light bounces and coloring the objects around were shot in Counter-Strike? Well, they are. Moreover, in the reworked maps, where the physical-based rendering is applied, lighting completely stands out. Even so, let's not jump the gun. It's impossible to imagine a game in 2023 without any application of physical-based rendered materials, and they look alright in Counter-Strike 2. They are obviously not as detailed as in Cyberpunk or Starfield at all, let alone comparable to Call of Duty or Battlefield, yet they are a fairly nice touch for well-known CS maps. Most of the scenes in CSGO look flat. Stone looks like it's made of a cheap plastic, as well as metal, wood, or whatever else. That's why the overall visuals feel repulsively cartoonish. This is not the case for CS2, at least in some maps, because all materials here properly interact with the light and have the data of metalness, roughness, glossiness, and so on. Sadly, the iconic Dust 2 and Mirage lack this upgrade and still look poor in terms of materials. Even in the new maps, they are nowhere near perfect. Starting with definitely not the best resolution of textures and PBR maps respectively, and finishing with some weird looking reflections in the shiny objects. Let's not get ahead of ourselves, this is a competitive game, it requires a really high FPS count, and the fact that PBR has made its way here at all, no matter the quality, is already a massive achievement. Another detail worth mentioning is the new SSR reflections applied in some minor locations, mostly on water surfaces. They don't massively change the visuals, but definitely make an improvement. On the other hand, shadows seem not to be meaningfully upgraded. All the shadows that you can find in the game are absolutely sharp and most of them are baked and fully static, except of course the player's shadows. It's a shame that even baked shadows lack the proper dispersion effect, despite the low performance penalty from the player's side. Moreover, even on ultra settings, the rendering distance of some shadows is unbelievably low. It's not even about seeing the cascade switch, it's about noticing the actual shadow being rendered at distance while moving. Overall, the shadow's aspect looks at least elaborated, and some improvements that can be easily made don't even require more rendering time. CS2, unlike CSGO, features a properly and uniquely implemented volumetric effect applied to a smoke grenade. In CSGO, if you drop a smoke, it creates a gray cloud of particles that blocks the visuals. This cloud is technically a set of sprites. If a player finds themselves inside this cloud, they will also notice the screen filter that turns everything gray and overlaps their view. This is a primitive set of techniques that was widely used to emulate smoke effects. However, if you look close, it has nothing in common with how smoke acts in real life. For example, you can't partially leave this cloud and view the outside. The border between being in the smoke cloud and out of it is rather obvious. This mechanic seems to be changed completely, and CS2, the gas dispersed by this grenade, acts like it does in real life. No more filter and visible border. The smoke is now a proper 3D object with physical properties, naturally blocking the view and scattering to fill all the available space. The simulation of this effect is surprisingly not based on the noise maps often used to create the volumetrics in games. It uses the voxel-based algorithm instead, where each voxel moves randomly in any direction until it bounces from a collider. This benefit can be seen while comparing the smoke grenade used outdoors and indoors. The amount of voxels generated by a single throw grenade stays the same no matter where it was thrown. However, because of the reduction of the available space, the smoke effect in closed spaces becomes more concentrated than outside. It's pretty close to any gas behavior. In closed spaces, the molecules of gas just can leave it through walls, and simulation in CS2 is doing great to represent that. In addition to that, clouds of grenades particles properly interact with gunshots and frag grenades explosions, which is also a nice touch. However, while gas and particle simulations are displayed as volumetric effects, there is no trace of them in the lighting system. All the god rays and fog you see in the distance are just fake transparent sprites. Despite requiring high FPS numbers for competitive gameplay, hardware utilization by CSGO is not the best, if not to say is completely broken. This game, released in 2012, uses an outdated DirectX 9 that doesn't support any proper multi-thread CPU usage and requires much more draw calls than properly integrated DirectX 11 that was available from 2009. DirectX 11 is not a perfect API by today's standards from any perspective. It still lacks most of modern optimization techniques, has issues with multi-threading and so on. Nonetheless, it allows to utilize more than one CPU core with real performance difference and reduction of the overall amount of draw calls when rendering the same scene. It also supports tessellation and a bunch of other new graphical effects compared to DX9. Yes, you guessed correctly, CS2 uses the DirectX 11 API, which is completely outdated in 2023, and was already outdated even 5 years ago. But for the series, it's a major step up, and finally players' hardware is no longer idling without properly sorted and optimized tasks. As you can see at this comparison, CS2 provides lower FPS when CPU bound, but taking in mind the upgrades, it's more than reasonable. What we want you to look at is the CPU core's utilization, which is a lot higher in CS2. This sensor can be 100% trusted, but it's obvious the improvement was done there. One of the most noticeable changes in terms of game functionality is the new tickless servers. Of course, they are just called that way. The ticks are there, and it's not true that Valve got fully rid of them. However, it's now impossible to find the evidence of their existence analyzing the game footages. There are still some moments when the game can make unfair decision, like at this shot, where the player definitely has stepped behind the wall, but got killed through it. But the only reason for this kind of stuff in CS2 is your own ping. So the amount of situations like this one got significantly reduced. You may ask, but how did Valve achieve this result? These lines represent the ticks of the server in CSGO. Imagine that there are two players, A and B. For example, player A has done some action on the timeline, and it matches the tick number 0. After that, player B has done something else, and they were unlucky that their action happened between the server ticks. It means that whatever their action was, the server won't register and completely ignore it. Of course, the window between the ticks is pretty small, but talking about competitive games, the existence of that window still means a lot. And what if player B was a bit luckier and his action was still registered on the tick 0? Then, despite the difference in time between his action and the action of player A, they would happen at the same time from the server's perspective. CS2 works differently. First of all, the server now works on the time-based system. It means that together with the action data, the user's computer also sends the data about the particular moment in time when the action was done. So even if the action done by player B was processed by server on the same tick as player A's action, the game logic will take in mind that it was done a bit later. There is also a fix to a missed tick action issue. It seems like CS2 doesn't only send the data packages for each tick, but also remembers the actions happening between the ticks and sends the additional small package that can be processed during the next available tick. Together with the time registering feature, it doesn't really matter what specific tick was chosen to process that, because all the actions will happen in the right order anyway. This approach has been known as server subtick, despite it having nothing really to do with extra ticks. It's easy to see that this system makes the game a lot more fair for the players. CS was always one of the most polished games in terms of competitiveness, but it lacked the proper fair system to indicate players' actions. Now it's fully capable of doing that. There is another key element that has been changed to raise the level of how CS2 is experienced by players. Technically, when you play CSGO, what you see on your display is not what actually happens on the server or on some other player's screens. The thing is that only the hostile damage is the data for the server to process. All the rest happens on your PC. Dead bodies physics, sounds, visual effects, and even bullet decals. Due to that, and the network delay, these details can vary from player to player, and the server just doesn't give a heck about all of these. As a result, a bunch of cases might occur during a gameplay session, such as an incorrect body collision that overlaps the side view of one player but doesn't affect the others, or a headshot sound appears on one device telling the enemy was defeated but on someone else's PC that never happened and the enemy goes on playing. This is where it comes to a new game changer in CS2, where all the interaction data is synced between the server and all the players in the game session, which leads to what one player sees is what the others do. I don't think it makes sense to get down to the differences, since they are pretty evident for anyone who's ever played multiplayer games. The good old Havoc physics engine in CS2 was swapped with a new in-house engine called Rubicon. There is not much available info about it, but it obviously improves the physics of dead bodies, the physics of dropped weapons that now can properly interact with gunshots and each other. It supports the close simulation, not sure where to find that in the game, to be honest. It's also worth mentioning that the physics engine has nothing to do with throwing a grenade, since in both CSGO and CS2, it's calculated by some individual formula, and it tends to ignore any material properties when bouncing off it. However, the grenade has its own noticeable interaction improvement. In CSGO, throwing a grenade in specific points with specific angle will lead to a grenade bouncing off the skybox. This doesn't happen in CS2. CS2 respects the data about materials' properties not only for lighting compute, but also for processing of sound reflection and absorption by them. On top of that, sound naturally dissipates at a distance. Simulation of sound propagation is applied to all sound sources and affects an angle, volume, and purity with what a player can hear it. This system is called Steam Audio. In terms of converting actual physical sound calculation to a final audio track, Steam Audio supports the ambisonic technology. Ambisonic is a sound format that stores the data not only about two sound channels and loudness, but also about the actual sound placement, respectively to player's position and the angles between the player and the final sound source, calculated by a simulation mentioned above. This system feels pretty close in terms of results to some other systems featuring software ray tracing implementation. However, there is no mention of ray tracing anywhere in official sources, and it feels like RT is not in use here. If RT was used, it would probably significantly affect the performance. Overall, CS2 is a massive upgrade of a proven successful game formula. Yes, it doesn't look as good as modern games, but for the Counter-Strike series is a big step ahead. Some decisions made in the new game feel a bit rough and unreasonable, but the number of, without a doubt, well-made improvements is impressive. CSGO has been around for over 10 years now, and the game series definitely required some updates. Well, here it is. If you're interested in this type of content or the videos about computer hardware, do yourself a favor by checking other videos on our channel. Also, don't forget about our Discord server, the link in the description. And as usual, stay up to date with HL.